that story, I don't know if I can preach a sermon. I've all seen birds that have found a way to get intoxicated. Is there an unpardonable sin? Have you ever committed the unpardonable sin? Not yet. You're planning to. Have you ever committed a sin way in your past? It would ruin your life in hope of eternal salvation. Did you know that the word unpardonable sin, those two words don't exist in the Bible? Because I hope that's encouragement to you. They don't actually exist in the Bible, and yet we talk about it from time to time. In fact, for some people, those two words, unpardonable sin, are as fearful as the word antichrist, or false prophet, or great tribulation, or even worse, the word witnessing.
Witnessing.
Some people are terrified of the idea of witnessing. What would someone think if they knew you were a Christian? Have you ever spoke to someone who was terrified they had committed the unpardonable sin? As a pastor, I've met a lot of people who were just burdened with guilt that they had committed the unpardonable sin. And do you remember the first time you thought about that question? Have I committed the unpardonable sin? Mark 3:29, whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit never has forgiveness, but is guilty of an eternal sin. That's a pretty harsh statement by Jesus, isn't it? Well, like I said, this verse has bothered a lot of Christians who are just troubled. That maybe they or maybe one of their friends or one of their neighbors has committed the unpardonable sin. Who asked the question, have I ever blasphemed against the Holy Spirit?
Yes.
And perhaps you've asked yourself that same question. Have I ever done that? Well, if you look at verse 35, it's really the key that helps us with verse 29. Whoever does the will of God, he is my brother, my sister, and my mother. Jesus says, in the context of this discussion, where he's talking about blaspheming against the Holy Spirit, Jesus says, whoever does my will. Is it possible to commit the unpardonable sin if you're doing the will of God?
No.
So what's the solution? That seems pretty easy, doesn't it? Why do we struggle so hard with it? Mark has a theme that goes like this. True religion consists not of external obedience to a set of rules, but a joyous and authentic relationship with Jesus Christ. Do you think those Pharisees had a joyous and authentic relationship with Jesus Christ? No, they did not. Do you think the disciples on a regular basis had a joyous and authentic relationship with Jesus Christ? I don't think they did. Authentic, but maybe not very joyous. That was a trick question. So, can you have a joyous and authentic relation to Jesus Christ because you were miraculously healed? And do you think the people who were miraculously healed in Mark 3, or that's the whole book of Mark, had that kind of relationship with Jesus Christ? Think about it, because these are trick questions. Are the descendants of Abraham, do they have an authentic and joyous relationship with Jesus? Is because your name is on the books of the church, does that mean you have a joyous and authentic relationship with Jesus? Not necessarily, does it? It's not a guarantee. It's something we have to be open to, isn't it? Something that we have to desire and seek after. Jesus is the preacher of good news. And he tells us something very important. It's not only important that he preaches the good news, but it's important that we accept the good news, that we become recipients of it, and that we have that joyous and authentic relationship with Jesus. Because having our names on the books of the church does not guarantee us that we have eternal life.
Amen.
So in Mark 3, Jesus is dealing with the escalating tension between him and the Pharisees. And the Pharisees will use two different groups to try to get to Jesus. He will use the disciples of John, and he'll use his own family to get to him. Now, let's back up a little bit, and a little bit of review. Chapter 2 of the book of Mark, verse 12, is the story of the paralytic. Now, I don't know what your heading for that chapter is. If I were to write the heading, it would be from paralytic to Pentecostal. Because that man was excited for Jesus Christ, wasn't he? Jesus said to him, "Son, your sins are forgiven." I remember the scribes and the Pharisees said, "This man is a blasphemer, because only God can forgive sins." Were they wrong?
No.
In fact, Jesus agreed with them. He said, "In order that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins, rise up, take your pallet with you, and go home." Jesus agreed with the scribes and the Pharisees. They didn't understand that they got it right. They had the right answer to the wrong question. Jesus moves on, verses 13 through 17, chapter 2, and he begins selecting disciples. Now, if you were looking to hire a pastor, would you go to the local bar, try to find someone to be your pastor? How do we know? Would you go to the gutters? Would you go to the IRS and look for someone to be your pastor? No, well, that was pretty harsh, wasn't it? That's what Jesus does. He goes and calls Matthew, an IRS agent, and says, "Follow me." And then Matthew throws a party. And who comes to the party? All these tax collectors, all these publicans, all these common people. All these undesirables. What do the scribes say? How can a man of God, how can a man who says he is a man of God, associate with such heinousness? And Jesus said, "Look, I didn't come to call the righteous, I came to call sinners. And I'll go wherever I have to go to find them." So Jesus is helping us by clarifying righteous by faith. Not only does he preach it, but he needs us to accept it. He needs for us to recognize where we are in our spiritual journey. He needs us to recognize our poverty, our spiritual poverty. Verses 18 through 22, that's where the scribes try to manipulate the disciples of John the Baptist. And they say to Jesus, "John's disciples are fasting. Why aren't you fasting?" Here the disciples, this is what John brings in. Yeah, this is a pretty good question. Maybe Jesus really isn't the Messiah. Now, the scribes are trying to plant these seeds of doubt. And Jesus talks about a wedding. And it says, as long as the bride and groom are there, the bridesmaids don't fast. They fast when he's gone. Now, in Jewish culture, weddings were a huge thing. It was a small town, everybody was welcome. So Jesus is emphasizing that true religion is a relationship to him. A relationship that should be full of joy and a relationship that should be celebrated. I wonder why it is that we have forgotten that. We've tried to make religion so sad and such a burden. When Jesus wants it to be joyous and to be a celebration. I know for some people that word celebration is just terrible. The sacrificial system was a reminder to us that yes, we should be humble. We should recognize our poverty spiritually. We should recognize that God is the solution to our sin problem. And that we were to rely only upon him for our salvation.
Yeah.
And the Pharisees missed this point. Especially the ones that lived in Jerusalem who saw the sacrifices, the morning and the evening, and they missed it. They made external obedience, regular fasting. They made their pride for self-righteousness the door to salvation. And sometimes we get seduced into that, don't we? If I just work a little harder, maybe God will be happy with me. And then Mark chapter 2, 23 through chapter 3, verse 6, is the issue of the Sabbath. Remember, the disciples were picking wheat, and they were eating it. And the Pharisees said, we have our rules, and that's not one of them. You're not allowed to pick wheat on the Sabbath. And then Jesus made this great statement. The Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. Isn't that wonderful? God made it for us. That's a blessing. And then he said, the Son of Man is Lord even of the Sabbath. And the Pharisees missed that because Jesus was once again claiming his divinity.
Amen.
And they once again missed it. Chapter 3, verse 6, the Herodians. Now the Pharisees and the Herodians were always fighting. But after what took place in chapter 2 of Mark, two worst enemies became allies, looking for a way that they might destroy Jesus, or at least destroy his influence. So those two major themes in Mark, true religion is a joyous relationship with Jesus Christ. It takes a lot of weight off us, doesn't it? And religion or Christianity should bring joy to our lives, not sadness. And that this relationship is available to anyone who surrenders themselves to Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Recognizes their spiritual poverty. Now Mark turns our attention to the crowds. Mark chapter 3, verses 7 through 12. Read with me. So then, verse 7, Jesus withdrew to the sea with his disciples, and a great multitude from Galilee followed, and also from Judea. So there were a lot of people pressing on Jesus. And he recognized that if he didn't get out into the boat, they would crush him. And verse 8, and from Jerusalem and from Judea, and beyond Jordan, in the vicinity of Tyre and Sidon, a great multitude heard all that he was doing and came to him. And he told his disciples that a boat should be stand ready for him because of the multitude, in order that they might not crowd him. For he had healed many, with the result that all those who had afflictions pressed about him in order to touch him. And whenever the unclean spirits beheld him, They would fall down before him and cry out, saying, "You are the Son of God." And he earnestly warned them not to make him known. Does Jesus walk big crowds? Is that his focus? Is that his mission to have big crowds? Are big crowds a sign of success? Intellectually, we would say no, wouldn't we? When we have an evangelistic meeting and we don't have big crowds, we say it was a failure. Isn't that right? So, one side of our, we're sort of like split personalities. Part of us says, yes, big crowds, we don't need big crowds. The other part of us says, it's really nice to have them. Isn't that right? It's really nice to have them. Jesus was not wanting to win the crowds by his miracles. He didn't send his disciples out saying, "Come to the meeting tonight. You're going to see Jesus jump from the temple all the way down and not get a scratch." He didn't do that, did he? Now, he did do miracles. And miracles were an expression of his compassion. He saw how hard life was for so many people, and he touched them and changed their lives for good. Miracles were a verification of his deity. As he said to the paralytic, "Your sins are forgiven, rise up and walk." And he used miracles as a way of illustrating truth. But Jesus spent long hours in prayer, staying focused on his mission, which was to preach the gospel, to preach the good news, and to be the Lamb of God, which would take away the sins of the world, and to die for humanity, as painful as that would be. And Satan was always looking for a way to convince people that Jesus' message wasn't important. All that was important was getting healed. Unfortunately, for many people, for the multitude of the crowds, that was true. Verses 13 through verses 19 of chapter 3, Jesus begins to select his apostles, his disciples. Jesus is limited to his body. He can't be all over the world at one time, so he's beginning to train these men to be his hands and feet. And that has not changed. Jesus needs us to be his hands, his feet, and his mouth, and to share the good news of the gospel with family and friends, with neighbors. Some scholars have suggested that only a small portion of those people who were healed by Jesus or set free from demons, that only a small portion actually believed his message. But the majority rejected Jesus. There were a few, like the paralytic or the Jairus and synagogue woman. There were a few. Can you imagine your whole life is transformed? You're healed of a terrible disease, but you reject the messenger. You reject his message. That's a tragedy. And so Jesus begins selecting. Because Jesus desires an intimate relationship with you and I. And he's calling us to an intimate relationship with him. So that we can, like his disciples, go wherever we're called to go and share the good news. Maybe that one person said, "Our job is to preach the gospel, and if necessary, speak. We are to be ambassadors of truth. We are to touch people's lives, to give them hope." Verse 14 describes three of the purposes that God calls his disciples and he calls you and I as his disciples. First, that they might be with him. Jesus kept them close like a mother hen with her chicks. They didn't understand something, he would explain it to them. There was much they didn't understand. And he was there helping them. And secondly, Jesus called the disciples to go out and preach. Now you might say, Pastor, I just can't preach. Well, whether we like it or not, we're preaching by how we treat each other. We're preaching. And thirdly, he gave them the authority to cast out demons, to deal with evil. Paul says we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against spiritual wickedness in high places. So God calls us to be his holy people, to be people who reflect and radiate Jesus. Then in verses 20 and 21, Mark shifts the focus from the disciples of John, who were being manipulated by the Pharisees to raise a question about Jesus, about the validity of Jesus' mission. Now Mark is shifting to the family of Jesus. Verse 20, and he came home, and the multitude gathered again to such an extent that they could not even eat a meal. And when his own people heard of this, they went out to take custody of him, for they were saying, what did he do? He lost his mind. And he was mentally unstable. The crowds were so demanding of Jesus that he couldn't even eat his meal. Now, in this culture, which Jesus is living in, if someone comes to your house, you feed them. And if you don't have enough food to feed the crowd, you stop eating, which is what Jesus did. Verse 21, it says, his own people. Who's Mark talking about? His own people.
Hebrews.
Who's that?
Brothers and mothers.
Yes, he's not talking about the Jews. He's not talking about the people who need healing. He's talking about his brothers, half-brothers and his half-sisters. And he's talking about his mother. You see, his brothers never really, at least at this time, had not accepted Jesus' mission as the Lamb of God which takes away the sins of the world. They did not accept it, and they were annoyed because the Pharisees were going to his half-brothers and sisters and saying, do you know that this brother of yours, what he's saying and how he treats the Sabbath, and they're going, oh, it's your fault. You need to reel him in. Desire of Ages, 3:21. They felt keenly, they referring to his brother, half-brothers and sisters, they felt keenly the reproach that came upon them through their relationship with Jesus. They were offended by this brother. He offended them. That's what she says here. They felt keenly the reproach that came upon them. They knew what atonement his words and works created, and were not only alarmed at his bold statements, but indignant at his denunciation of the scribes and the Pharisees. You need to be nicer to the people in charge. You need to go along with them. You need to, be like a politician. Say a bunch of things and never mean anything. So they decided that he must be persuaded or constrained to cease this matter of labor. Isn't that kind of shocking? This is his family. These are Joseph's children. These are the kids that he grew up with.
He had a Baker Act.
Pardon?
The Baker Act on him.
The Baker Act, okay. And so the Pharisees are excited. Because they've enlisted John's disciples, now they're enlisting his family, who are saying things, and now the family's saying he's lost his mind. And the brothers, thinking they won't have enough influence, they pick poor Mary. And they think, well, they just get Mary to come. Jesus will do whatever Mary asks. Now, Mary was the closest to Jesus, not because she was his biological mother, but because she was a woman of faith. It says, they came to take control of Jesus. And the word that's used here, that Mark uses, means literally, they came to arrest Jesus. To take him by force if necessary. And they knew what was best because they were his brothers and his sisters. And the scribes, seeking the opportunity, created a trifecta. The disciples of John, the family of Jesus, and now, verse 22, and the scribes who came down from Jerusalem were saying, he is possessed by Beelzebub and cast out demons by the ruler of the demons. So the brothers say he's out of his mind. The disciples of John say, well, he really ought to be fasting. And the scribes say, he's of the devil. And with a hardened heart, they looked at the supremely good one and claimed that he was the supremely evil one. Notice verse 23. And he called them to himself and began speaking to them in parables. How can Satan cast out Satan? And if a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. And if a house is divided against itself, it will not be able to stand. If Satan has risen up against himself and is divided, he cannot stand, but he is finished. Verse 27, but no one can enter the strong man's house, and the world is the strong man's house, and plunder his property unless he first binds the strong man, and then he will plunder his house. Truly I say to you, all sins shall be forgiven the Son of Man, whatever blasphemies they utter. But whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit never has forgiveness, but is guilty of eternal sin, because he is saying he has an unclean spirit. When Jesus makes this statement of blasphemy against the Holy Spirit, it's in the context of this trifecta that the scribes and the Pharisees are setting up. How can one who is destroying demons be the leader of the demons? Jesus is the one who is binding Satan, who is plundering his house. And so he's making this strong warning to the Pharisees, to the scribes, who are claiming that he, the good one, is really the evil one. And that's when he makes this caution to them about rejecting truth. Mark 3 says that Jesus was angry with them and compassionate. Jesus is saying to these men, be careful. Be careful because you're headed on a path of destruction. Now, the scribes were convicted that a divine power attended Jesus. But in order to resist the truth, they attributed the work of the Holy Spirit to Satan. Did you catch that? They were under conviction that this was the Son of God. He'd given them many examples. Only the Son of Man has the authority to forgive sins. I am the Lord of the Sabbath. He gave them so much evidence, and they were under conviction, but they resisted it. Said he was of the devil. Now, it's easy to be critical of the scribes and Pharisees, isn't it? They're the bad guys, but when you think about it, They're the ones who are calling the nation of Israel back to the Word of God. They're the health reformers of the church. And this is bad to read the Bible, isn't it? And this is bad to have health reform. But these men were manipulated as a tool